Thank you, Dick Taylor. Good morning, everyone. Hear these words from Isaiah 61. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causes the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. Let's stand together as we sing.
Wonderful start to this beautiful spring morning. Welcome to First Methodist Church. My name is Kyle, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to worship this morning. First things first, I'm going to ask you what I ask you to do every week, and that is check in for worship. If you have a smartphone with you, you can pull it out and go to the First Methodist app if you have it on your phone. Otherwise, you can go to tulsafmc.org and look for the check-in links right there on the homepage. You can scan the QR code in your pew. It'll take you to the same place if you want. Or you can use one of the cards in your pew pocket, and you can put it in the offering plate a little bit later. Checking in helps us keep our systems up to date, and it's also a great way for you to get a little bit deeper connected here. Once you give us your information, we will help you get connected with others here at the church so that you can go deeper in your faith. While you guys are doing that, I'm going to say hello to everyone worshiping online with us this morning. Hello. It's my pleasure to welcome you. Whether this is your first time or your 100th time, we are so glad that you are with us this morning, and we hope you feel the grace and love of our Savior, Jesus Christ, through your screen today. Well, I just have one thing to talk about, and that is Holy Week. It starts next Sunday. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We will begin Holy Week with the procession of the, procession of the palms. Our children will come through waving their palm branches, and we will celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And then on Thursday, we are having our Holy Thursday meal and remembrance of the Last Supper. That's going to be down in Thomas Hall at 6 p.m. Just a reminder, that is a ticketed event, and so you will need to purchase a ticket in advance, $5. You can find the reservation system online at tulsafmc.org/Easter. And I will say, tickets are going fast. We do have limited seating for that night, so if you'd like to attend, get those tickets today. If you aren't comfortable with our reservation system, just give us a call here at the church, 592-3862. We'll help you get registered, okay? And then on Good Friday, that's Friday, April 7th, we are having our Tenebrae Service of Darkness here in the sanctuary. It begins at 7 p.m. It's a great service to remember the night that Jesus actually died and went onto the cross for our sins. It's a great service. The choir does a wonderful job. I hope you can join us that night, because then it sets the tone for Easter Sunday so that we can celebrate our risen Savior together. We will be here in the sanctuary on Easter Sunday. That's Sunday, April 9th. That's 2 weeks from today, 9:30 and 11, and it's going to be a wonderful day. We will celebrate our risen Savior together. All right? Thank you.
Please stand as you are able and join me in the Apostles' Creed, number 881. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
invitation comes to us to come and see the beauty of the Lord. You may be seated.
Come and see the beauty of the Lord. Come and know the wonder of His grace. Come and see how much He cares for you. Gaze at the compassion in His face. The nail prints in His hands. Find a friend who truly understands. Come and stand beneath the blood-stained cross, proof of His unchanging love for us. He is worthy. He is glorious, He is wonderful, He's everything to me.
Can all God's people say amen? I'm going to do something a little bit different for our prayer time this morning. One of our global mission partners, Elizabeth, is preparing to go out on assignment this very week. So I want to invite Elizabeth to come forward at this time. We're going to have her kneel and anoint her for her journey and for the work that God is inviting her to do. And I'd like to invite any who feel so moved to come forward and to lay hands on Elizabeth this morning. Elizabeth is going to a mission station in Central Asia. She will be building relationships. She will be about a ministry of prayer, of teaching English. She has been a global mission partner for the past 8 years and has been a missionary through VIM trips for many more years than that. As we lay hands on her today, we are going to be doing what Christian people have been doing since the time of the Acts of the Apostles, which is to call upon the Holy Spirit to anoint her for her mission. We will be going with her in spirit, if not in body, and thereby fulfilling the calling of our Lord Jesus in Matthew 28, to go out into all the world and to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything that our Lord has given us, knowing that He will be with us now and to the very end of the age. And so, Elizabeth, our sister, I anoint you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we pray that the Spirit would be poured out upon your life to cover you as a blanket from the top of your head down to the bottom of your feet. We pray that God's favor would rest upon you. We pray for the protection of the Holy Spirit. And we pray most of all that the Lord Jesus Himself would be your North Star, would guide you as His light, as your salvation, would be the lamp unto your feet and the light unto your path. And we pray that your life, that your words, that the actions of your body, and that the love of your heart would bear witness to the place where you are going. We pray that by your witness and example, many would be called to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that He would use you as an instrument of His salvation in the world, that you, dear sister, would be one through whom others would be called out of darkness and into His marvelous light. We pray also, Lord, that you would call not only our sister Elizabeth, but that you would call many into the mission field, both out of this congregation and elsewhere, that your kingdom would be made visible upon the earth, and that the church would be built. We know that through the power of your word, the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And we pray that you would make us that church, that we would be not only a church that is called to worship, but a church that is also called to go out into the world in the strength of your Holy Spirit. We pray that your anointing now by that same Spirit would fall upon us, would fill this very room, would fill Elizabeth, and would fill many of the brothers and sisters to do this same work of evangelism and mission in our very day. And we pray that you would heal the hearts of those who have been wounded, that you would bind up the brokenhearted, that you would make every grief and every sorrow disappear because of the joy of the kingdom that is coming even now into our hearts. And we pray that you would make us as one body in Christ and fill us with faith as together we pray the prayer that you've taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. The scripture reading this morning is from John chapter 9, verses 1 through 11. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. After saying this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. Go, he told him, wash in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors And those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they asked. He replied, "The man called Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed, and then I could see." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. The ushers are invited now to come and receive the offering.
To the sea.
Thank you, Joseph, and thank you to choir for that beautiful offering of praise to our Lord Jesus this morning. Good morning. I have one thing I want to mention before we get into the message today, and it is about this fantastic looking invitation card here. We're in a series on evangelism, and one of the things that I mentioned to you last week is that statistic that over 80% of unchurched people indicate that they would be willing to consider attending a house of worship if someone simply asked them. It's a remarkable statistic, really. And Kyle Westfall has created a way for us to ask people. These cards are cards for our Holy Week services from Palm Sunday through Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and all the way to Easter morning itself. And we printed 4,000 of them, so you can take as many as you want. And I hope that you will take as many as you think that you can make use of. When you leave, if you go out to the front entrance of the church, right there at the welcome desk, we have them there, and you can take them. I'm going to take some and just keep them in my car. And every time I go in the grocery store, I'm going to take a couple with me. And I'm just going to make sure that I have a couple in my briefcase. And if I come across anyone and it seems appropriate, I'm just going to put this in their hand and say, you know, there's a website on the back, our phone number, our address, and a schedule of services. Christ is risen. He loves you. And I want to invite you to come and to worship Him this coming Holy Week. So one of the things that people talk about when you ask them about evangelism is they'll say sometimes, I don't know what to say, right? I don't know what to say. This is not something that I've ever done a lot of in my life, and so it makes me self-conscious. Well, the wonderful thing about an invitation card is you don't have to say a whole lot because everything that you'd want to say is on the card. And so I want to challenge everybody here, please don't leave the church today without taking a handful of these and making sure that in the next couple of weeks you really use them and invite people to come and see what God is doing here at our church. Amen? All right, with that said, will you bow your heads with me and let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we give you thanks that you are one who has heard your people's cries and you have come to us in the person of Jesus. That though we be born blind, yet through His power can we see. He brings us out of the darkness and into light. And all He asks is that we bear witness, that we tell the truth about what we have experienced in Him. Will you make us an evangelistic people? Will you fill us full of a magnificent obsession to share His name with others, to share His good news, to invite, to encourage, to tell people to come and see who this man, Jesus, really is. And now, Lord, will you make me a fit vessel to share your word? And will you make all of us ready to hear, ready to receive the message that you have for us this day? And we ask that you would make this so, Father, through the power of your Holy Spirit, and in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. When Paul is writing to the church in Ephesus, and he's trying to get them ready for battle, he uses a phrase which is the armor of God. He tells them that they are to put on the armor of God. It's a familiar passage to a lot of us, and it's an important one. It's the passage where he talks about putting on the belt of truth and the breastplate of righteousness and the helmet of salvation and all the rest. What he's doing is he's trying to get the believers in Ephesus ready for warfare. But it's a special type of warfare, isn't it? The warfare that he's trying to prepare them for is a spiritual warfare. And he makes that clear in a verse early on in this passage from Ephesians chapter 6, where he says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." Just as a side note, I don't believe that I ever really came to an understanding of who the Holy Spirit is until I came to grips with this passage and others like it. Earlier in my life, I walked around believing that what I could see with my eyes was all that there really is in this world. At the time, I did not have an adequate understanding of the spiritual nature of reality, nor of the way that the spiritual parts of reality and the material parts of reality interweave one another in a way that is close and is inseparable. We are surrounded by angels and demons all the time. Did you know that? We are. We are in this room. You are in your home. When you're driving down the street, when you're at work, when you're at the grocery store, we are surrounded by angels and demons all of the time. And there are spiritual forces, both good and evil, that are at work in this world. When we come to realize that, we can come to an understanding of how important the Holy Spirit is in our life. You hear me? It's only when we come to an understanding that the world that we see with the eyes in our head is not the only world that is there, but there is a spiritual world that is even more real than the world that we can see with our eyes, that we come to an understanding of the importance of our relationship with the person of the Holy Spirit and with His power. There is, after all, a reason why when Paul is giving this account of the armor of God, this image of all of these items, the full panoply of arms, the full suit of armor, there is a reason why he waits till the end to talk about the one offensive weapon in the entire kit. And do you know what that offensive weapon is? It is the sword of the Spirit, he says, which is the Word of God. He waits until the very end to talk about the Holy Spirit and uses the image of a sword that is given to us that we might have the ability to wage offensive battle against the forces of evil, against the forces of darkness, to do battle in the name of Jesus and for the sake of His kingdom. But how, we might ask, how are we to think about this struggle that Paul is talking about, and how are we to think about it specifically in relation to the work of evangelism? That's what we are focusing on during this season of the year, the calling and the work of evangelism. See, the Bible often deals in dualities or in pairs of things that are opposed to one another. And in the dualities that the Scripture uses to describe for us what it is that we face in this world, there is no duality that goes deeper in the Scripture than the duality of darkness and light. And you hear that in the passage from Ephesians 6, where Paul says that we have a struggle against the powers of this dark world. In 2 Corinthians, when he's talking about the problem of the gospel not being received by some people, he uses the image of the fact that the gospel is veiled to them. It's an image of darkness. That the gospel has been veiled to people who cannot seem to grasp the truth. And this is what he says in 2 Corinthians 4. He says, in their case, the God of this world, who is our enemy, who is Satan, in their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the very image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. It is always an image of darkness and light. This world is veiled in darkness. And Jesus is the one who has come to bring light into the world. One of the things that the God of this world, that our enemy does to confuse us, to sow confusion in our hearts, is to convince us that we are already walking around in the light. Did you know that? This is one of the things. You see this, it expresses itself in our culture all the time to try to make people believe that they're already in the light when in fact they're stumbling around dangerously in the darkness. And that confusion, that very cultural message, that message of the world is one of the things that makes evangelism so difficult and perhaps makes evangelism more difficult now than it has been since the time of Paul himself. One of the towering figures in the Methodist Church in the 20th century was a man whose name was Earl Hunt. He was born in a small town in the hills of eastern Tennessee. In obscurity, really. But he was very bright, and he rose to prominence quickly. After going to seminary and serving as a pastor for about 15 years, when he was just in his 30s, he was named the president of Emory and Henry College in East Tennessee. By the age of 46, he had been elected a bishop, and he went on to serve almost a quarter century, almost 25 years, as an Episcopal leader in assignments from North Carolina to Middle and West Tennessee down into Florida before his retirement. He came from a relatively humble background, as he writes about, but in his prime, Bishop Hunt was the establishment. He was a bishop in a time in the church's life when bishops were the elite of the elite. And yet in his retirement, when he could have coasted, he could have ridden the speaking circuit, earning no doubt large fees for his time. Instead, he devoted himself late in life to the relatively humble work of evangelism. He became the president of the Foundation for Evangelism in North Carolina, which was an organization that for many, in the height of mainline Methodism in the 20th century, the Foundation for Evangelism was an organization that many people looked sideways at, that many others did not trust. He himself writes about the fact that in the mid-20th century, in Methodism, in the mainline, the word evangelism itself had become a dirty word. In his 1994 Denman lectures, Bishop Hunt described the problem of the mainline church by using the phrase, cultural captivity. This was the church that he himself had served. This was the church that he had been practically a prince of, that he had risen to the heights of power over. He was the president at one time of the Council of Bishops, yet in his retirement, he looked back on his half century of ministry, and he described the church that he served as one that was imprisoned, was suffering from a cultural captivity. He pulled no punches in saying that there were vast and sweeping changes that were needed if the mainline church were going to regroup itself for evangelism in the coming years and decades. That is something, by the way, that he wrote and spoke 30 years ago in 1994. It did not happen, for the record. The approach of the mainline to Christian spirituality is a dead letter. It's dead. It's not coming back. That's something I'd like to preach an entire sermon for that I'll have to save for another day. We are not a mainline church. We are a church of the Holy Spirit. We are a church who will be hungry for the kingdom and who will be hungry for evangelism, or we will be no church at all. Do you hear me? We are a church who will bow down at the cross of Jesus Christ, who will claim Christ and Him crucified, who will proclaim the resurrection of the risen Lord Jesus, and who will be hungry for the power of the Spirit in our lives, or we will be no church at all. When his Denman lectures were put in published form later in the year that he gave them, the publisher recognized that his words had stirred up so much controversy that they had to offer an explanation for it on the back dust jacket. This is how gauche, this is how uncouth a robust endorsement of evangelism was seen as in the latter years of the mainline church. The interesting thing about all of that is that when you read those same lectures today, which I have in the past couple of weeks, the thing that strikes you is that there's nothing remotely controversial about what he's saying. All you can say about what Bishop Hunt saw was that he had a keen insight into exactly what was happening when he was speaking and what would happen in the subsequent 3 decades. But even just 30 years ago, the mainline church in America was still a place of great enough prominence that people could be scandalized by someone who simply spoke the truth. You see, part of what Bishop Hunt was doing was trying to describe how American culture had changed so dramatically over the course of the 20th century. And one of the ways that he puts it is this. He says, within the last half century, the big words have lost their meaning. Listen to that. The big words have lost their meaning. The words that once held our world together. Words such as God and heaven, salvation and faith, hell and eternity. And he is absolutely right about that. The God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers. That's what Paul says in 2 Corinthians. The God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers. One of the reasons that the older approaches to evangelism no longer work is that no one is really focused on their eternal souls. People don't think about that. The outlook of this world has become secular. And by that, I don't just mean amongst atheists. The outlook of people in this world, even those who claim Christ, has become essentially secular. People are worried about this life. They're worried about the creature comforts, the experiences of this life. They're not thinking about that which lies beyond. Most people don't understand that their battle is not against flesh and blood, but is against the powers and the principalities at work in this dark world. And it may not be in our power to change the culture with the snap of our fingers. It isn't. But we can ask what it means for how we are called to do the work that God has called us to in this day. I had a colleague for many years, a wonderful pastor named Rob Williams, who used to say to me, Andrew, the best thing that you can do for people is just tell them the truth. The best thing that you can do for people is simply to tell them the truth. You see, our world tries to tell us that what we are meant to do is to be nice to people, right? Never to ruffle people's feathers. Never to say anything to people that they'll disagree with. Rob used to say, that isn't true, Andrew. The best thing that you can do is tell people the truth. You have to. You're not doing them any favors if you lie to them. You're not even doing any favors if you round off the rough edges of the truth to make it more palatable. You just have to tell them the truth. The story that Pastor Connie read for us this morning comes from John chapter 9. I had her stop at verse 11. The truth of the matter is that that story takes up almost the entirety of chapter 9 of John. Jesus heals this man who was born blind. And that little detail, the fact that he was born blind, is one of the keys of the story. It isn't someone who suffered an accident and became blind. It isn't someone who contracted some type of illness that blinded him at a later point in his life after he had reached adulthood. The very first verse of John 9 says specifically, a man who was blind from birth. In his village, everybody knew that. Everybody knew that he was always blind, that he wasn't someone who was going to come home one day, having recovered his sight, like getting over the sore throat of a cold. So the story starts out with this theological conversation that Jesus is having with his disciples. They come across this man. They recognize he's been blind from the day he came out of his mother's womb. And they say to him, why is he blind? Was it something that he did that he's being punished for? Or was it something rather that his parents did? It has to be some reason that he's been punished for this. And Jesus shuts that down in a hurry. He tells them that God does not inflict punishments like that. The disciples are barking up the wrong tree entirely. Jesus tells them, what God is in the business of doing is bringing light into the darkness. You got to get out of that either-or thinking. God isn't punishing people with blindness or with illness because of something that they've done. God is using the circumstances of this fallen world to bring people out of darkness and into light. That's why they've encountered that man on that particular day. And Jesus reminds them of that by telling them flat out, I am the light. I am the light of the world. Then he rubs some mud on the man's eyes. And he tells him to go wash in the pool of Siloam. And he does, and he's healed. Now that's it for Jesus in the story. That's as far as we got today. Jesus is gone. The story's not over. It's not even half over. When this man who's been born blind walks into his village with 20/20 vision, everybody freaks out. Nobody understands what's going on. His neighbors are so confused by the situation that they become convinced that it's not really him. It's just somebody who looks like him. And so they question him. And they take him to the Pharisees, and the Pharisees question him. And the Pharisees go and talk to his mom and dad. And they don't want to have anything to do with it. They don't want any part of the controversy. And so they say, go back to him. So they go back to him, and they question him again. And the thing about this whole story is that the man could have said anything. He didn't have to court controversy. Jesus was gone. He didn't even ask anything of the man. He just healed him because he loved him. And he wanted to bring him into the light. And the man could have made it easy on himself. But what the man does in the midst of all of that commotion that is swirling around him is important. And it is especially important for us. And it's important for the cultural situation that we find ourselves in. The same cultural situation that was emerging when Bishop Earl Hunt wrote what he wrote 30 years ago. What the man does is that he tells the truth. He could have kept his mouth shut. He could have lied, but he doesn't. He tells the truth every single time he's asked. His neighbors demand to know how it was his eyes were open, and he says, the man that they call Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. Then he told me to go to Siloam and washed, and so I went and washed, and then I could see. And the Pharisees ask him how it is that he's recovered his sight. And he says, he put mud on my eyes and I washed and now I can see. And they go to his parents and they come back and they start trying to intimidate him. And they say, this man doesn't keep our Sabbath. There's no way that he came from God. He's a sinner. Sinners can't do the things that you're saying that he can do. Tell us, how is it that you can see? And the man says, whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know, but one thing I do know. I once was blind, but now I see. He does three things. He points to the action of Jesus. This is what he did. He points to the authority of Jesus. This is what he told me to do. And he points to the outcome of Jesus. I once was blind, and now I can see. There was a particular image of evangelism that took hold in the 20th century that we've never really gotten over. We've never really gotten over it. It's like we have this evangelism hangover. And the image is the image of the preacher on the soapbox. I've encountered these folks. They're still around. They're still around doing the same thing that worked in the 1920s, thinking it's going to work in the 2020s, and it doesn't. The image of the preacher on the soapbox warning people to repent and get right with God before their date with eternity, it's an image so dominant that it became self-identical with what evangelism came to mean. But what do we do, friends? What do we do when we find ourselves in a cultural situation where people are no longer afraid of their sin? And what do we do in a cultural situation where people don't even recognize that they have sin in their lives? It doesn't even occur to people to think that they commit sins or that they're subject to the power of sin. One of the ways that you hear people talk about this transition in our culture is of the transition from guilt to meaninglessness. It's not that we don't have problems anymore. It's not even that people don't recognize that there's something wrong with life. It's that they just don't feel guilty anymore. Instead, they feel as if their lives lack meaning. They're in despair. Now, the root of all of this is still sin. Just because people don't recognize sin doesn't mean that they're not subject to its power. If anything, the enemy has been so successful at sowing confusion that he's made us believe that our problem is something that it's not. But nevertheless, whether people feel guilt or whether they feel despair, the root source of all of it is the problem of sin. The challenge for us, though, is that we have to meet people where they actually are. We can't meet people where we want them to be. We have to meet them in the place where they actually are. And we take people as we find them. If the way that we find them is not through an epidemic of guilt, but through an epidemic of meaninglessness in their lives, then what evangelism becomes for us is simply telling the truth about Jesus. Telling the truth about the one who knows no darkness, in whose presence the darkness flees, because he himself is the light. Look, I can't explain everything about who he is, the man said, or what he's doing, or why he did what he did for me. But one thing I do know, I once was blind, but now I can see. When Bishop Hunt was talking about what it would take for us to get re-equipped for evangelism in this century, he said that the calling to evangelism means that the Christian man or woman redeemed by Jesus Christ and filled with the Holy Spirit must make the task of witnessing to his or her faith the magnificent obsession in life. Y'all can buy me the biggest, nicest soapbox you can find. But if you think that sending me as your preacher out onto the street corners in the city of Tulsa, shaking my fist and warning people to repent of their sins like John the Baptist of old is what's going to be effective, I have another thing to tell you. I'm looking at the evangelists right now. They're all out there in front of me, sitting in the pews of this church. And if you want to know what's going to bring people to faith in Jesus Christ, it is you bearing witness to what Jesus has done in your life. We have to tell people the truth. And in order to tell them the truth, we have to be willing to tell them the truth. You have to be willing to do it, friends. The soapbox preacher has no more cultural cachet. People don't feel guilt. Our culture doesn't teach them to, but what they do feel is a deep and a pervasive lack of meaning in their lives. They can't see. They cannot see because they've been blind since birth. They're stumbling around in the darkness, and every cultural message that they receive is trying to tell them that they're okay, that they're actually in the light. But deep down, they know they're not. They know their lives make no sense. They know they have no real concrete and objective meaning and value. And even if they don't know how to put it into words, they are desperately hungry for someone to take them by the hand and bring them into the light. This isn't just something that's meant to be an occasional hobby for us. It's meant to be our magnificent obsession. The obsession of our lives. It is the task that is ahead of us in our time. One of the things that is so challenging about even those of us who are believers is that the world has become so overwhelming that we don't feel like we can make a difference, but I'm here to tell you that every time we tell the truth to someone about Jesus, we are making a difference. Every time you're willing to take one of these and share it with someone, you're making a difference. Every time someone asks you how you're doing and you respond by telling them what the Lord has done for you, you are making a difference. Until we come to that realization, we have not yet said yes to the calling that God is placing on us as individuals and as a congregation. And so let those who have ears to hear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the church. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you pray with me? Give us the faith, Lord Jesus, of the man born blind, who, because of what you did for him, could see. The gift that you gave him was not only a gift of sight, but it was a gift of willingness to tell the truth, to bear witness for what you have done in this world and of who you are. Will you make us like him, that we too could tell the truth and so re-evangelize this culture for your kingdom? Jesus, we ask this in your name and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm going to offer you this invitation. You may have stumbled in here blind today. You may have come in here believing you could see because of the lies the world has told you, but have come to realize that your sight has not yet been given to you. If that's the case, I want you to know that Jesus is calling. I want to offer you this invitation right here and now, that if you desire to know Jesus as Savior and Lord, he is right here in this room. And he is ready to meet you. As we sing, I'd invite you to come. Come and visit with me, with Pastor Connie. We'll introduce you to the most important person you can ever know. Let's stand together as we prepare to sing. Will you come?
Amazing grace. Shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I'll never know just why Christ came to love me so. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous that grace that caught my falling soul. He looked my fault and saw my need. It was for me he shed his blood on Calvary to pay the debt that I could never pay. It was for love he made a way for you and me. He looked beyond our fault and saw our need. I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary, cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous is grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond my fault. He looked beyond your fault. He looked beyond our fault and saw our need.
After the next service is concluded, I'm going to be going over to the YFC and meeting with our class of confirmation students. We've talked about how quickly Easter is coming upon us, but shortly thereafter, we will be celebrating Confirmation Sunday, and there is a class full of boys and girls who have been studying all year long and being formed in the Christian faith and are preparing to come before the church to make their public profession of faith in Jesus Christ. That is something that should fill all of us with joy. And I hope that over the course of the next couple of weeks as we get ready for Confirmation Sunday, that you'll be praying for that group of confirmands. The step that they are about to take is the most important step that they could ever possibly make. And we rejoice with them. We rejoice with their teachers, with our youth ministry staff, and all of the mentors who've been pouring into their lives over these last few months. As you go from this place, I charge you to go with the faith of the man born blind, who was made to see and given the ability and the heart to speak the truth about Jesus. Go forth from this place filled with that same spirit, a spirit of boldness to speak into this dark world words of light. Go knowing that the love of God, that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with you now and always, and go in peace. Amen.